So, our next thing is feeder. Hey. Anybody who's schlepped feeder will tell you, it's really heavy stuff, okay? Well, why is it so big? Well, it's carrying a lot of current. You know, this feeder we have, I mean, it's rated at each one of those legs has got to carry 400 amps. And when you think about it, your safety ground, it has to be able to carry that maximum amount of current through it too. So it has to have the same current rating as all the neutral and the hots and all of that. It's got to be just as big, even though it's green, you know? Even though it never carries any, on some worst case scenario, it's got to carry that maximum current into the ground, you know? So why is it so heavy? Because it's stranded copper, and copper is very heavy, you know? These power conductors, you'll see these, or what are those connectors? This is the Camlock J series. It's these, you've seen these here, okay? What's important about these is they have a rating of 600 volts, okay? The max you're gonna put through them is 208, you know? 600 is what their voltage rating is, and they'll carry 400 amps through the connector itself, and they mate together. There is a smaller F-series that you'll see occasionally, like on a pyro or something like that. You've seen those, Julie, the smaller. Every once in a while, you'll see those for some little one. Those have a rating of 120 volts, and they're rated at 150 amps, but they're not that common. Mostly, we just see these. You know, these are what are called the J-series, what are called Camlock connectors. It's a company name, but it's sort of a generic term, like thermos, you know. This is what they look like. This is the male Camlock over here, the female. What's important on these is this gap, okay? That gap is very important because when you compress that gap, it wants to push back out, and that is what actually makes contact, the tight contact that you need right at that junction so that you don't have any resistance in there, you don't have an air gap, it's a nice tight fit. Because remember, when you're at full power, you're going to be sucking 400 amps through that junction. It had better be tight, it had better be good. Otherwise, it's going to get hot. You know, you're going to try to pull it through there, there'll be a little bit of a gap, a little bit of resistance, you could get some arcing, not safe. It's got to be a good, solid connection. One of the reasons for this class is something that happened last summer to me, and I wasn't even really on the electrics crew. I was just doing feeder with a crew. And we went to plug in Jimmy Buffett's brand new, not brand new, but his rented equipment that was a first show. And we went to plug in the distro, and I looked at those things. I plugged them in, and they turned right back. They didn't lock down. They were very, very loose. And I looked at all the feeder, and there was no gap in any of those male connectors. They were completely smashed. And I went and got the head electrician. I said, look at this, man. These cables aren't, they're not locking. He goes, oh, we just got this rig, man. He goes, I can't believe it. So there's supposed to be a tool. You've seen this, too. There's supposed to be a tool you can use to go in there and widen that out. He didn't have the tool. So he and I sat there with hammer and screwdriver. Put a screwdriver in there and just like tapped on it to kind of widen it out and get the gap, and I'd show him my, you know, I'd show him my thing there, and he goes, okay, that's fine, try to make that, you know, and so, but if I hadn't been there right at that moment to see that, somebody would have just plugged in all that distro, and it would have just failed. I mean, it was horrifying to see that, you know, but as soon as I saw that, I went and got the head electrician. I said, look at this, man, this isn't gonna work. You got no power here. This, I mean, it's just like, I plugged in, it just turned right back and fell right out. You know, it's like, oh my God.
Well, another thing to look out for is older Camlocks, because in the male, there's a flat surface on top, and on the female, there's a little bump. And when you're putting it together, you have to line up your bump and your flat, and you turn it.
She's now, talking about how they make your...
If you look in there, and if your little bump is missing, that thing won't lock down.
What you do is you find the place where it wants to go in. And then you push it as far as you can all the way in, and then you turn it, and it's gotta be tight. That's tight, you know. If it, like when I did it, and then it should pull out. When I did it, it was just whoosh, whoosh. I mean, I turned it, and it turned back on its own just with the amount of tension that was in that cape. I mean, you should see her face right now. She's horrified. You know?
Yeah.
Right, I'm thinking, this is Jimmy Buffett, you know. know, that power fails during
the show, you know, the neutral could have fallen out here.
I mean, this is Jimmy Buffett. He's not going to put up with power failure. That guy's going to lose his job over that, you know. So, I mean, I was very fortunate to be right there, because, folks, we're the first line of defense against this kind of crap. You know, you see something like that, go get the head electrician, point it out, find Julie, find Todd, find Matt, somebody who knows, and just say, look, this is a problem. I think this is a problem. And
one of the things, just to point out in our business, mm-hmm. common sense.
Right.
Use common sense. If it doesn't look right, if it doesn't feel right, feel right, go with your advice and go with your gut instinct. Use common sense of what you're doing.
But like I say, this is the critical point where we're getting power. And if it isn't right and those cams don't lock down, it's going to be a problem, man. You know, and these shows are really sucking a lot of power, you know.
And that wasn't Buffett's first stop?
It was the first stop with the rented lighting gear.
Okay.
They had never actually hooked up that rig before.
Okay.
So I don't know about the lighting truss and all that, but the distro and the feeder and all of that was rented. And it was the first show for that rented gear. And the guy goes, I just got this. What are you telling me? It doesn't mate? And I go, no. And he went through and tried a bunch of them. They were so bad that he and I spent 45 minutes with hammer and screwdriver and widened all of them and went through. And I mean, he was like, thank you for pointing out that my rig was, you know, not going to work there, you know. But like I say, we're the first line of defense.
Actually, and that was just in the cam locks.
It was just in the cam locks.
Actually, what could have happened was somebody could have used, mm-hmm. when you put them on, they're pain. Right. I put cam locks together. Somebody might have like had a pair of pliers or a pair of vice grips, mm-hmm. holding on to it to get it together, mm-hmm. not realizing when you clamp down on that, you're going to lower that gap. Yeah. I had never heard about the gap.
Right.
And now I realize.
Mm-hmm. That's what it is.
That's something to look for, especially in older equipment. As this equipment ages.
Mm-hmm. As you mate it, the mating thing in there, as it mates and mates and mates, it's like metal. It flexes a little bit, but that gap, you know, you push in on that gap and it wants to push back out, and that's what makes contact around the outer side. The flat thing that she's talking about where you lock it, that's where it locks in position. But it's that pressure of that thing outward that's what makes the connection right there. These are feeder tails. They're usually on top of the box. Most of our houses don't really need feeder tails so much. You'll see them in Canton where we don't really have cam lock connectors on some of the power feeds down there. But almost every other house we have is, Julie will tell you, it's just cam connectors.
Well, as the theaters have improved over the years, that it's been standard that they'll go in and they will mm-hmm. actually put a box and actually have.
Yeah.
But like an EJ Thomas, mm-hmm. I can open up a box and actually go.
Right. They may only have feeder tails, but will have cams, I think. And they'll look like this. This is just a new one that I got from Jerry. That's what it looks like.
It's just a wall mount.
Yeah, it's just mounted on the wall. I'll show you some pictures of the service panels. Feeder cable is always at the bottom. It's heavy. This is a sound power thing. You can see how it's deployed there with the green and red and all that. This is the one at EJ. That's the one at the Akron Civic. That's called the company switch for sound. These are the lighting panels at EJ. Julie recognizes these, all three of them there. And those are the ones, 400 amp, 200 amp lighting, and it has the connection procedures there. Company switch. You never plug cam locks into the company switch as a stagehand. Don't ever do that. Don't try to do it. Don't even think about doing it. It's a big no-no. The head electrician is the only authorized personnel that can tie that in. That's what's called the tie-in. Your job is to deliver the proper cam lock connector, it's usually the male, to the base of the company switch. So always ask the guy which end goes, you know, if you're not sure which end goes, because sometimes their stuff might be backwards or something, always ask them which end goes to the base. Generally stay about 3 feet away from that company switch. You shouldn't really be right next to it or whatever. You know, there's electrical code specifies that there's this 3-foot zone where only an authorized or licensed electrician should be in there working on that thing. So if you deliver it about 3 feet from the company switch with extra, because sometimes what they'll do is they'll plug those cams in and then they'll suspend the swag from a rope or something just so the cable doesn't hang by the cam lock connectors, because they tend to be like 3 or 4 feet off the ground. So you don't really want them to hang down like that. Sometimes they'll dress up. They'll put
well,
like a string.
It's just a safety issue. You always want slack.
Right.
A little bit of slack. You don't want the tension on it.
Right. Give the head electrician a little bit of slack on the cable so they got 4 or 5
string
feet extra.
Relief,
string
yes.
relief that's to it. Do it. That's it, you know. But, you know, like I say, as you're doing this, there's certain, like, practices that a lot of us know because we've been doing it for a long time, you know. But
well, generally,
people, yeah.
You always want the male end of what I call the hot, the black, the red, and the blue. You always need the male ends to go to the power source, to the tie-in box. Now, it varies, depending upon their rig, whether they have their neutral and their ground or reversed, or they're straight. At E.J. Thomas, they happen to have, and at a Civic, it seems, when electricians install these boxes, they have all female cam locks sticking out that you attach to. So we have to have what they call turnarounds, which is one of the straight barrels, which then I can make the female into a male, and use what I have to do.
Yeah,
but usually it's the male ends of the hots that you want to go towards the box.
And mostly the electricians will deal with those turnaround and mating issues. You know what I mean? You're just, as a stagehand, you're just delivering the cable and making sure that they have enough and all of that stuff, you know. As far as the cooking into the company switch, if you're not the head electrician, you'll never do the tie-in. It's not your...
No, it might be a fact where if you've done a lot, if the electrician is comfortable with you and the electrician is really stuck somewhere and they're screaming for it, it's like if I'm working with one of the other electricians who's done tie-in or I know someone's very good, it's like they're going, I say, Debbie, could you please go over there? I got to deal with these people.
Yeah, they've got something else to do.
And I can turn to them and say, could you please go ahead and do that? Or if sound is so desperate, they're like, Julie, we can't. I'm like, I trust
you. Certain departments need sound. Certain departments need power before other departments, you know, depending on motors.
You need authorization from the head electrician.
Right.
I can't be there right now. It's desperate. We have an emergency.
Right. So leave enough in, and then you'll run the other end to the distro, okay? Now, if it's more than 8 feet, you should probably coil the excess cable in what's called a figure eight pattern, and we'll show you why that is in a second here. This is what a figure eight pattern looks like for a single cable. I couldn't really find a good picture of, you know, the 5 wires in a figure eight there. There's a really good reason for that, and the reason is that you don't want to coil it in a circle because electrically, a circle of cable creates what's called an inductor. Okay, and what an inductor is it's a very concentrated magnetic field, and if you create an inductor with this big coil of wire, that can create a strong magnetic field and it'll clog and corrupt the power that you're trying to get through your distro. It's literally like pinching the hose right there, okay? It can create electrical problems that are kind of outside the scope of this class. But what you do is if you coil it in a figure eight pattern, you have 2 coils side by side that are 180 degrees out of orientation with each other. They cancel out. So a single coil creates an inductor, 2 side by side, they're 180 degrees out of phase, it cancels out. So whenever you have excess feeder, you always coil it in a figure eight pattern, okay? And that cancels out the magnetic field there. Sometimes it's not an issue, you know? Just ask the head electrician, how do you want this excess cable? And he'll say, figure eight it right here. And then, or you know, he'll just say, just coil it right there, it's not a big deal. We never had a problem.
Generally, just standard cable, it's...
Yeah.
The feeder cable, you always want to figure
eight. Right. They'll be really impressed if you offer to figure eight it. They'll like that. Then they know that you understand that you can't have, you know, that right there. So here's your power connections. You can see how this is our standard little distro there with black, red, blue. But then over here we see red, blue, black. This is one I saw. This is a photograph I saw. Pro Power or somebody like that came through with that thing. Obviously, it's not Canadian, otherwise it's, you know, not right. But you'll see that, you know, to where the colors are just, you know, their own little thing there, A, B, and C.
Either that or you're reading it from the other side.
Yeah, but I mean, I actually looked at that, and that's 1, 2, 3, but yeah. Yeah.
So, would you always have a rig that's either one or the other? I mean, you're never going to get something like the picture on the right here with red, blue, black, and then you got to connect the red to the red on the distro box here on the left.
Colors always match. Yeah, colors always match.
Colors match.
I mean, it wouldn't throw it out of phase or anything. It would still be correct, even if I connected a piece of cable between that red and that red.
Well, yeah.
You won't know if it's going to be a phase issue until you actually turn it on.
It's not a safety issue.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a phase issue. What she's saying is you won't know until you fire up the motors and see which way they go.
Oh,
I see. If you hit the up switch and the motor goes down, you end up to phase.
So you don't swap over because you don't want to go, oh, my heavens, it's different.
But, there's no rules in the United States, so it could be...
You're going to connect the box on the red and the box on the right to the red on the box on the left.
Right. Yeah. Always, reverse, always, always
match. Reverse phase, although, on it.
Right. Always match the colors. Right.
Well, and if you notice on that little distro box, you see the top has, like, all females on it, and the bottom has males, because that's a pass-through.
Right.
Okay.
So anyway, these are some of the things that you'll typically run into. And like I say, in the United States, they've asked for the situation because they haven't specified that in the code. It can be any of the three colors. Sometimes you'll see these multiple splits on here where you go in and there's a whole bunch of outs there, you know. That's how AC power gets distributed. It's usually just a simple switch, split, and multiple splits are common. We see them all the time, you know.
A lot of times they refer to that as the PV box, or power distribution box. If Stagehands says, give me the PV, that's what they're talking about.
Okay. So here's where we ran into problems at the last class. Does the plugging order matter? Okay. H.L. Mencken said that every problem has a solution that is simple, straightforward, and wrong. Okay. What I mean here is, if you look at this in its simplest aspect, the plugging order doesn't make any difference. And here's why. It's because nothing you plug in should ever be hot. When you're running feeder, when you're plugging feeder into the distro, and you're plugging from rack to rack, and all of this stuff, motor distro and dimmers, and you're doing that job, there shouldn't be any power on at all. It's all dead. It's just a bunch of wires going into a bunch of connectors. There's no electricity present, okay? Sometimes there is. It happens. It's because that guy's overzealous and he does the tie-in and flips the switch and you don't know it and you start plugging things in and you don't realize you're plugging in feeder that's hot, okay? The better answer is, those cables might be carrying voltage, and they might be hot. And when they are, the plugging order does matter. But just understand that you should never be plugging anything in, feeder or those multiple pin sockos when you're plugging in those big lighting fixtures and all of that stuff. Most of the time, when you're plugging that stuff in, there's no current going through that wire at all. There shouldn't be. It happens. Julie will tell you.
Well,
it happens.
Well, and once in a blue moon where you have no choice
right.
but to plug in hot.
Right.
And I've done it enough. I trust right. myself enough.
Right.
I'm very careful to keep people away. And I would do it in the summertime sometimes. And I had a friend of a 2x4.
Right.
But yeah,
well,
no, in all seriousness,
suffice to say,
push you
yeah.
off if,
but. Uh-huh. If you have to do it, you need to just follow. So it's a lot easier to teach people, go this way.
Right. So when you plug in, you always ask before you plug any of this stuff in. The guy may not want you to plug in his distro. He may want to do it himself. You never plug anything in unless they ask you to, okay? You got to plug in the proper order, and that's this. You always plug this in first. That's your grounding connector. You always plug in that green one first. Okay. You will then plug in the white one next, okay? And we'll tell you why that is in a second here. You then plug in your phase leg conductors last, black, then red, then blue as you're going across. And you'll find that this is the easiest way to do it when you just start at one end and work over. When you disconnect, you unplug blue, then red, then black. Again, when you're disconnecting, there shouldn't be any power energized on those things. The power should be cut before you disconnect. And as a matter of fact, you should make sure that that power is completely off by either looking over at that panel and making sure that it's down or making sure that the cam locks have been disconnected from the thing and make sure that you're not handling cam lock connectors that are energized. You should never handle cam lock connectors that are energized. Okay? It's just that. It happens. Avoid it. Avoid it at all costs. Okay? So you unplug the legs first, blue, red, black. Then you can unplug the white connector next. Then you unplug the green one. Okay? Now the order is important because when you plug in that green thing, that gives you your safety path to ground. Once you get that connected, you've got your safety to ground and you're good. Okay? When you plug in the white second, that grounds your AC power. Okay, all of a sudden your system is grounded at 0 volts. Now you're starting to hook up the equipment and you're literally grounding your electrical system at 0 volts when you plug in that white one. And then you plug in the phase last, makes these accidents far less possible and deadly. Because at that point, if something happens, if you take one of those legs and it happens to be energized, and it happens to touch the chassis of the distro or something, that distro is tied to ground and all that electricity is going to go into the ground. It may spark, you know, it may startle you, but it's not going to shock you because you're connected to ground, the electricity goes into the earth, you're safe. And that's what we want. That's why you do the green first. Because things happen out there. Stuff gets energized and you're plugging in stuff that's hot. And it shouldn't happen, but it does. That's why we teach the right word.